Hi friends, I welcome you all to the course Open Data and Open Source Applications for Water Accounting and Auditing. Here we are going to see about the basics about water accounting, auditing and hydrological models. First of all, water accounting. Water accounting is a scientific or systematic study on water potential, water demand, water supply and water distribution system in the particular domain or particular watershed or basin or any administrative boundary. And then water auditing is additional to water accounting. We relate the water governance and management activities in the particular basin, and also economic, what are the expenditures are in the particular basin, and also what are the benefits in the particular basin system. We are all together interrelated. That is water auditing. And why we are going for water accounting and auditing? What is the need? Is the big question. Because water governance is a hot topic in the current situation of Earth. So for water governance, it is mandatory to have some base data. So without data, we can't do any management analysis for anything. So in water system, water accounting is very useful to collect the very reliable data on the total system, and also auditing is very useful to relate the constraints over the water system, which plays a major role on the system issues like a drought and a flood. So it's a water accounting and auditing is very useful to water governance professionals and also the decision makers. Actually, water governance is a simple mechanism or process through which water resources are accessed, managed, and the water related conflicts, how they are managed, that will be comes under the water governance. And another basics definition about hydrology and hydraulics. These definitions, sorry, people are known from your bachelor degree itself. The hydraulics is a study of water, everyone know. Technically we can say it's a conservation of mass. We consider the only mass conservation or continuity equation in our study, that will be under the hydrology part. And the hydraulics, the name is means to the pipe flow, but the actual hydraulics part is consider the conservation of mass, energy and momentum. Wherever you consider the three phenomena, mass conservation, energy conservation, and momentum conservation, that will be comes under the hydraulics. This is a water cycle. H2O particles move through the land and subsurface and also atmosphere. In that, our study is focused in which part? You are just studying the rainfall amount, runoff amount. That would be under the hydrology part. The mass conservation only we can take in that hydrology. For example, quantity of flow is a river hydrology, we can say. And hydraulics part is the momentum and energy part will come to the study. The energy of flow is a river hydraulics. Energy of flow, sediment, and whatever the hydraulic structures you are going to place in the river or any storage area, we will consider as a hydraulic design, not a hydrology. If you are just going for only runoff calculation, that would be a hydrology part. And another one basics, a model and a simulation. The hydrologic model means any watershed or a basin system which is replica by the equations or any virtual models. That the model is a replica of the real system, which consists of water, soil, and other hydraulic structures. Whichever the components are placed in that real watershed, that would be represented by the model. Another one is a simulation. Simulation is the replica of the real system process. Previous one is model is a system, and the simulation is a process replica. That will simulate what are the process going on the real earth, that will be is converted as a virtual or analytical process. And then type of models in hydrologic, three major types of models are there. One is a lumped model. There is no spatial variation in that characteristics. If you take this is a small watershed, here this is a lumped model means the overall watershed characteristics same, like a soil type, land cover, or any other coefficient you are going to use in the particular watershed or sub watershed, that would be a same value. No spatial variation means that's a lumped model. And then one semi-distributed models, that will be that same watershed divided into some sub-watershed, sub-units. And that particular sub-unit, the data or characteristics of the unit is same. No spatial variation in a particular unit of the total system. It will be semi-distributed model. The another one is distributed model. It is like a finite element method analysis. The whole system is divided into small segments. This would be based on our resolution, which resolution you are taking, 10 by 10 or 100 by 100, whatever. A small gridded area will be generated, and each grid have a same property for rainfall and cover, whatever. If you are increasing the number of grids, that results will be more accurate. That will be distributed models. Next one. This is a typical single reservoir system. It's a component of the hydrological system. First one is streams, rivers. It's a natural system. And the reservoir or dam is a man-made constraint in that particular system. And then supply and management constraints. So it starts from the surplus from upstream. If there is no upstream watershed, there won't be a surplus from upstream. And another local catchment. It's a local catchment of the particular reservoir. It gets water from upstream. If it is the topmost watershed, no upstream flow is available. Only local catchment flow is present. And then water comes and stored in the particular reservoir. The reservoir fills the water surplus to the downstream through the river. And for that water supply, we can get water from the sluices and can supply to the demand. It's like a agriculture area, so irrigation demand means from that demand we can get the return flow. If the urban means, the grey water will come as a return flow. In agriculture, I used drained water. Drainage water comes as a return flow to the river. It's a typical system. It will be multi reservoir, multi watersheds. It will be connected. So same will be replicated to the same will be repeated to the all others. It's an important thing. What are the basic data we need to do a hydrological model simulation? First one is topography of the particular basin or watershed, and then meteorological data, rainfall, temperature, and wind speed. Another one is land cover and soil characteristics. Next one, the particulars of hydraulic structures, that means length, height, and other physical parameters of the hydraulic structures which are present in that particular basin, like tanks, dams, river tailings, or whichever likes regulators, anything. And then population, human and cattle. For demand estimation, we need a population data. Now, some water demand of irrigation, industry, and others. It's the irrigation demand is available as the second data, we can use it directly. Otherwise, we have to do some study on irrigation demand and also industrial. So these things are based on the policies which are the industrial use and other uses. And next one is the water management policy and field level management. The demand is particular X value, but the management policies allows only the Y value to the particular demands. So we can take the supply from the policies and rule curves for the reservoirs, how they are operating the reservoirs, in which level they are storing water, and which level they are using for demand, and in which level you are supplying water to the downstream reservoirs. Thus constraints will need to address on that particular hydrologic model. And then types of data. Generally we have only two types, primary and secondary data. Primary data means we have to We collect directly from the land, like measuring the rainfall through the rain gauge, or going directly to the field and take the soil test. That would be comes under the primary data, and secondary data is a processed data, like we downloading land use data or any sediment data from the websites, or directly taken rainfall data from the IMD website or any other sources. That will be comes under secondary data, whatever the process, even that satellite images, whichever is processed, that would be comes under the secondary data. We go not going to use the raw data for the any GIS analysis. Whatever we are downloading from the website, that will be a secondary data only. And few open data sources here I mentioned. One is for digital elevation model and other GIS database. So open topography. So website have the data for whole world. The DM data is there. Other processed and LIDAR data is also available for any specific places only. The link is available in the bottom, you can use it. And then other one, USGS. This is also have a worldwide data for land use, land cover, digital elevation model, and the water streams, water bodies, whatever you needed for a GIS analysis, all data available in the single place. USGS Earth Explorer. Here I mentioned the link. You can use it. We have to do some sign in with our data, and then we can download the data freely from that website. And other one is Bhuvan. Is data available only for India. They have reports and maps, processed maps, and also raw data of DEM and land use, land cover, resource map. All are available in that website. I just giving as a hint where it's available. Just go and just browse it where also the data is available. So whatever the data you needed for the some GIS analysis for a watershed, we can get it from here. And another one website for Indian country is India Water Resources Information System. Here real-time data also they are uploading, the sediment data, water flow data, water storage available in the reservoir, like that they are updating. The all major reservoirs have live data here. We can get the daily data or any particular month on a yearly data, whatever you can just select and make it as a report. Also we can download as a CSV files for all flow data and storage data. Just we can go through all menus, you can get the more data and maps, whatever you needed. After so many websites are there, these are primary, and also I use this one, that's why I mentioned here. Other data, open source data are also available. And open source application, here I mentioned whatever I used and also whatever I'm going to teach in during this course, that only I mentioned. First one is a VEEP, water evolution, it's evaluation, is here a spelling mistake. Water evaluation and planning, this is used for hydrologic model simulation and scenario analysis. And a QGIS for mapping and watershed delineation. It's a best GIS tool as a open source. Another one is a crop pod for irrigation demand calculations. Other Google products, Google Earth Pro, Google Web, Google Earth Studio, so many products available for mapping and any land cover validations. The real time, almost the real time data is available. And the Google Earth Engine is an advanced one. This is working based on our code. That almost 37 years of satellite data, image data is available here. We can use it by our coding. That will show the results based on our code. It is very useful for almost every analysis related to the water resources. and HMS is also open source hydrologic modeling system. It is used for get a hydrologic data. You can estimate the peak flow of the river. And another one is ACRAS. It is very useful for flood mapping. So many other uses also there for all the applications. I only mentioned what is going to tell you, and also what is used for mainly for water counting. That only I mentioned. Just go and explore a website and see what are the optimum usage of these applications. Friends, how the VP is working. First you are going to model the hydraulic system on that application based on a GIS techniques, other additional tools. If the natural slope have some watershed boundary, but the man-made activities converted the boundary into something other, which is not in that, not with respect to the DM. If they are used any road embankment, any other railway embankment, they are not following the hydrological system characteristics. They directly put the embankment, and that the watershed boundary is changed based on that embankment. The water stream is change the path based on the human activities. That will be modeled initially, and the data which is inputted at VPS works based on the satellite data. Also, we can modify modify the data with our observed data. And that physical and operational constraints, how the water stored, what are the reservoir storage capacity, like then are the constraints, and then model simulate based on our conditions. That will give the results. Based on the result interpretation, we can give a project feasibility. In the separate class session, I will just explain the water accounting by VEEP. Just here, just telling what is available, and QGIS for my watershed delineation and mapping, all GIS related things we can do. QGIS have so many plugins that will be more useful to any specific analysis through the GIS. And this is a small methodology for the demand calculation. It's a typical one. For demand, one is major is irrigation demand that would be estimated through the CropBot software. Another one, domestic demand is a major one that will be separated for rural and urban and transition stage. I just based on our Indian country limitations, and also in South Indian water availability in rural, the 70 liters per capita is considered for the demand, and urban 135 liters per capita, and also in standard stage 100 liter per capita per day. This is a variable. I used these things for my analysis. You can change based on whatever the demand available in the particular area you're going to analysis. And additionally, we have to add the industrial demand. How many industries are, how much percentage of water is supplying to the industry based on our policies, or any other, what are the exact water used by that industry. That will be considered as a industry demand. And eco flow. This is a mandatory to sustain the system environment. You have to let the some percentage of water as eco flow in that system to maintain the environment sustainability. The all together come to as a total demand of the system. This is on a crop what used for estimate the irrigation demand, rainfall and temperature data, and the crop data, soil data would be given as a input. Total irrigation required for a unit, a crop area, that will be estimated here. Then HMS, for computation hydrology, you can use the HMS software. This is open source. The watersheds and watersheds area and reservoirs and junctions and reach properties will be given as a input, and it is simulate and give you a peak flow at any point wherever you are required. It will give you a flow for a particular date. It's the best software. And then for computational hydraulics like flood mapping, can use a crash as a river analysis system. That would be used again GIS tools, base tools, and also hydraulic equations for a hydraulic analysis. You can do analysis for any hydraulic structure on the river, off the river, or any storage structures. We can analysis how if you installed any structure on the river, how the effect in the particular system. We can analysis that one. Also, you can use it for a flood mapping, and you can map your flood vulnerable zones through this one. This is a very precise results where we can get. It's also one of the best software for hydraulic analysis. These things are some basics related to our whole course. In that, based on these basics and also these softwares only, we're going to discuss in the upcoming sessions. The next session is about the open data kit. That video is separately uploaded. If any queries, kindly mention that commands. Directly you can ask through the mail. Thank you.